Hello everyone, welcome to Team Adonis's podcast. Welcome back. Hopefully you guys got a lot of information out of the first episode. I know that it was a little bit boring to listen to. It was kind of me reading off mostly a script, and I'm pretty sure I said that in the podcast as well. But in the future, and this has come from some really positive feedback, and I appreciate everyone that chimed in with their feedback and how to make the podcast better off. But just basically getting some guests in and having like that back and forth chat will really like liven up the podcast, you could say. And they will also have questions, things that they say, and then I can then rebound off that and then give some good feedback off their questions, what they say, and things like that. So that's just one thing, not one thing, but a few people chimed in and said that would be really good. And hopefully looking into the future, I will be doing that. But today I'm changing it up and I've just got some notes and I don't actually have a script that I'm reading off. So hopefully it feels a bit more lively in this podcast and it's a bit easier to listen to. So the podcast today is going to be talking about strictly fat loss phases, and we're going into detail in the podcast. It's long form information compared to my Instagram posts and stuff like that. This is going to be long form, so we're going into detail, but not everything will be covered in this one podcast, because if I did that, the podcast would go for like 3 or 4 hours. So I'm going to try and fit it in into a good 40 minute window or even 30 minute. And yeah, it's all going to be about fat loss. And to start off, I thought the biggest thing that a lot of people get wrong with a fat loss phase is they're all excited to do it. And then when they get 2-3 weeks in, they begin to complain. And that's either to their coach or it's to themselves, or they begin to complain to people around them or something like that. And the thing that you have to realize is, you chose to go into a fat loss phase. Like, unless you've got a coach, and if you have a good coach, they will let you know, oh, you know, this is what we're going into, this is the phase we're going into, I believe you're in a good spot to go into this fat loss phase, and then you would chime in with your opinion, and if you said yes, and the coach is like, oh, all right, all good, we'll put everything into play, and then like 2-3 weeks later, you're just like, nah, like, stuff this, I don't want to do this anymore. The coach is going to be like, you know, what the hell? Like, you just kind of like blindsided the person and you've almost blindsided yourself. So it's important to know that it's voluntary. Fat loss phases are voluntary and you choose to do them. So if you get 2-3 weeks in or even longer and then you start making excuses for yourself, it's voluntary. So yeah, you can just back out of a fat loss phase. Like, no one's stopping you. But at the end of the day, you're not going to get results that you're looking for. So there's two sides of the coin there. So, you know, there's the part where you back out, or there's the part where you keep going. And you know that it's voluntary. You just kick yourself in the bum and you're like, okay, I just have to get through this. I do everything I can for the next, you know, the weeks that are leading up until your fat loss phase ends, and then you'll see awesome results, and you kind of get through that way. Of course, there's strategies around, and that's what I try and do at Team Adonis, is to make sure that that process doesn't feel like your life's put on hold, doesn't feel like your life's restricted. So, but sometimes, like, they can feel like that, especially if you're going into a contest prep or you're bodybuilding for a show. Yeah, it's pretty hard to avoid that final 5 weeks unless you're on substances, to be, you know, just absolute trash. So it's important to know that it's voluntary. And anyway, once you go into a fat loss phase, you're in it, you're in the deep end, and you're straight away in a caloric deficit. So remember from the previous podcast, I touched on it. We have our maintenance level calories, which is our daily maintenance that we eat, and that'll transfer to our weekly total from that daily maintenance. And then if we wanted to lose weight, anything under that daily maintenance or the weekly maintenance will ensure that we lose weight. And it's directly related to how much you lose compared to like how many calories you take off. So if you take off 400 to 500 calories, most of the time you'll lose around that amount of weight in a week to 2 weeks, most of the time. Sometimes that won't be the case and it'll be a little bit different, but most of the time that's what's going to happen. So if you take 500 calories off, you'll lose 500 grams a week most of the time. It's really easy to then calculate how long the phase should go for and stuff like that. Okay, so with rates of loss, if we were to just straight away go and ask ourselves a question, all right, if I could just lose a kilo a week, you know, I could just strip 1,000 calories off and then just go from there. And it's like, yeah, but 1,000 calories is a lot. You're going to tell the difference for sure. Your training's going to take a massive hit. Your mentality's going to take a massive hit because 1,000 calories, that's like 2 meals for most people. And it's going to be really, really detrimental to just your daily life in general. And like I just said before, your training. So it's important that we have a smaller rate of loss. So the rate of loss that I recommend at Team Adonisi is a 500 calorie daily deficit, and that equals to a 3,500 weekly deficit. So this ensures that when we're training, our training is going to remain the same, our performance will remain the same, and also our weight will be going down and we'll be holding onto muscle tissue. Okay, I'll talk more about this later in the podcast, but your training performance is directly related to the amount of muscle that you're holding onto during the fat loss phase. So if we're going into a smaller deficit like this, a smaller rate of loss, which will equal to about 2 kilos on average for 4 weeks of work in a fat loss phase. So you can already tell that a fat loss phase to lose, for example, 6 kilos is going to take, you know, anywhere from 12 to 16 weeks. And the slower, the better. We want to hold on to the muscle tissue that we've worked hard to gain. And that is going to give us that toned look when we strip all that fat away, hopefully just fat. And then we still have the muscle tissue there. That's going to give us that toned, lean, strong physique look. So if you have a smaller deficit, perfect. And it's important to note that the weekly calories, they're the main driver of fat loss. So if your weekly calories are not 3,500 below your weekly maintenance calories, then more often than not, you're not going to lose that required amount of weight. You could be in a 500 calorie deficit for 5 days, and then on the weekend, you eat back in maintenance calories, and you'll still lose weight because you're going to end up in a deficit. But you won't lose as much as what you would if you were at 500 calorie deficit for every day of the week. That's one of the biggest things that, going back to that voluntary side of a fat loss phase, is one common thing that I've had people say to me most of the time is they'll go into a fat loss phase and they will be like, oh, cool, can I, you know, still go out with friends? Can I still drink? Can I still do this? Can I still do that? And of course you can. Like, you know, training and nutrition, especially nutrition and being in a caloric deficit, shouldn't just take over your life and then you start have to bring your scales to like the restaurant and be like, oh yeah, could I just have some, instead of chips, could I have some rice, or, you know, just let me weigh out my chicken. And then the waiter will be looking at you like, what the hell is this guy's problem? Just eat the freaking chips. But yeah, the thing with that is again, it's voluntary. And if you're going into it already with the mindset of looking for shortcuts, then, you know, it's going to be kind of ridiculous for you to be in a fat loss phase. You may as well just stay at maintenance or go into a very, very, very slight deficit. Like, I'm talking like 100 to 200 calories, and you'll be losing weight at a ridiculously slow rate, and it'll almost be like you're at maintenance. Even the, like, losing a kilo will take, like, close of 6 to 10 weeks. But if it's the path you want to go down, then you're going to have to do it that way. But if you do really want to be serious and get the results that you want to, yes, you can still go out with friends and all that stuff. And I teach you at Team Adonis here the protocols to make sure that those nights out and stuff like that don't affect your results. But yes, you can, but don't go into the mindset of a voluntary fat loss phase, and then straight away think of shortcuts. Another big one with the shortcuts is, asking about refeeds, asking about diet breaks, asking about when your calories are getting bumped up next. That's another one. Don't go into the mindset in a fat loss phase of straight away thinking about when you can have a break. The biggest thing is just getting through, doing the work, and when you have a smaller deficit, like I recommend, then, you know, the refeeds and stuff like that are just kind of icing on the cake, and it doesn't really get to a point during the fat loss phase, unless at the very end, like the last 3 to 4 weeks, I would say, then you could start to see some, you know, dieting effects. But most of the time, you'll be completely fine during a fat loss phase. And you're not going to need those refeeds just because your mental state isn't at a good spot and you're like craving food. Those refeeds will be more so for training, and you'll have the refeed and your training will go next level on that particular day or that particular 2 days after that refeed. Your pumps will be better. Your lifts will feel better. And then when you go back on a calorie deficit, it's not like your training just goes down the drain. Your training will still be, you know, maintaining, but it's way different to if we did a refeed where you've just been an 800,000 calorie deficit and you're craving food, your training goes up and then you go back down again and it's like a big slump. So in terms of looking at the scale, as it's very important for tracking your weight and seeing the results and obviously seeing the rate of loss on the scale. The scale is a big thing, it's a big factor, and you need to track your body weight every day. If we're not tracking our body weight every day, then what's going to happen is on Monday you might be 70 kilos, on Thursday you might be 71.5, on Sunday you might be 71, and you'll be like, what the hell? If you assess your results from just those three, you'll think you gain like a kilo, but in reality your weight fluctuates. So it's pretty common knowledge now, but some people still don't know this, but your weight can fluctuate 7 days of a week, and your weight can go between a kilo, especially for girls during their cycle, it can change drastically, and I'll cover that soon. But your weight can change within a kilo, and that's just in general. That's during a maintenance phase. That's not even during a fat loss phase. So it's really important that you track 7 days a week, weigh yourself at the same time every morning before you eat, when you go to the toilet. Sorry, after you go to the toilet, you can't weigh yourself while you're going to the toilet. That's silly. But yeah, make sure you weigh yourself after going to the toilet and record what you do and then get the weekly average. The weekly average weight is what we're worried about. So you would assess after 4 weeks, your weekly average weight changes. And if you're losing about 400 to 500 grams every week, it's not going to be 500 grams perfectly, then, you know, you're on the right track. Especially if you're training and performance in your training is staying in the same areas. But if your performance in the gym is going down and, you know, you're losing like 600 to 800 per week, then what you can do is probably add a little bit more food in. Now, vice versa, if your training is remaining, you know, well, your performance is still going well, but you're only losing like 200 to 100 grams per week, then you're probably going to need to go into a little bit of a bigger deficit, and there's probably some tracking errors there on your data in terms of tracking online fitness power and stuff like that. What I recommend at Team Adonacy is either way, so if you're losing too much weight, you add 100 calories back. If you're losing too little weight, then you decrease 100 calories, and that's daily. And that usually evens the playing field out. So I touched on before girls during their cycle, and I just wanted to touch on it really quickly. Girls and body weight fluctuations during their period is going to be really, really big, especially during that week 4 where they do have their period. Your body weight can fluctuate between 1 kilo to 2 kilos, and that's due to obviously the bleeding and things of that nature. And it can also affect you mentally, because some girls will get really big hunger cravings on their cycle, and especially in that 4th week. So it can be a lot harder on girls during a fat loss phase to not binge eat during that 4th week. So ensuring that you're taking the right supplementation, you're tracking your cycle, and you know and you have the correct data of when your cycle is going to end, when it's going to happen, that'll allow you to estimate and plan out when your body weight is going to fluctuate up. So it's not, you're not looking at the scale after 3 weeks of progress and you've been doing awesome, and you look at the scale in the 4th week and you completely forget that you're on your period, and you look at the scale and you've gone up like 1 to 2 kilos, and then you're like, whoa, and you kind of, you feel disheartened, you get in your head, and at the end of the day, it's not your fault. Like, it's just a natural occurrence, it's what happens. And even in some cases for girls, their training performance will get affected as well during their cycle. On the flip side of the coin, some girls train really, really well in their cycle, and their lifts actually go up heaps, especially in the 3rd and 4th week. They have just a bigger, they have just, like, their energy to train is just bigger, for whatever reason, and I'm not 100% sure on that reason. I'm gonna have to do more research on that, but from my experience, training people, especially girls, that 3 to 4 weeks can be one, or can be either side of the coin. But yeah, for girls, just being aware of that scale weight, and it can go up 1 to 2 kilos. So I touched on before that assessing our data over 4 weeks is going to be best, and then making changes based on that 4 week data. So again, going back to females and you girls, when tracking within your cycle and making sure that you're tracking it properly, we can't, as girls, we can't assess the data just week to week or every 2 weeks. We need to assess data as a whole over 4 weeks, factoring in your cycle. Because if we were just to assess data over 1 week, every week, that fourth week when you're on your period, that would just drastically change what data you have and the results. And it's just not true, because you're having your period. So ensuring that we're tracking that 4 week block and then assessing results from there is going to be the best way to go about things. So when you assess your data from this 4 week block, you look at your calories, you look at your body weight fluctuations. This is when you would take measurements. This is when you would look back at your weekly photos and videos that you've taken for your physique to see where changes are being made and things like that. And then you make necessary changes from there to your caloric amount. And this can either be adding in more steps to increase activity levels to burn more calories, or this can also be to decrease calories further to remain in a deficit. So that's pretty much how you go about it in simple terms. I wanted to touch on training, and then we're going to leave the podcast there. So in terms of your training, your training shouldn't change. So during a fat loss phase, it's very common for individuals to think that they have to go lighter and they have to do lighter weights, higher reps, drop sets, supersets, all this stuff. And they are beneficial, especially in the last couple of weeks of a fat loss phase when, you know, things are, you know, getting really, 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 really difficult, really, really hard on your body and your joints. Again, being in that slow rate of loss, like I recommend at Team Adonisi, you won't experience any of that stuff and you can continue to lift heavy and progress within your lifts most of the time. So, training shouldn't change. So if you are going lighter, you should not be. You should be always focusing on strength and muscle progressions in the gym. And that through Team Adonisi, that's leveling up in your lifts, in the main lifts that we cover, which is squat, deadlift, or press, whatever lifts are your main lifts as an athlete, as a member of Team Adonisi. We continue to progress on those and we continue to implement progressive overload, hanging on to training performance for the entire fat loss phase. If we're changing training, then more than likely we're going to be losing muscle tissue as our muscles aren't training at the same intensity as what they were when we were in a maintenance or in a lean building phase. So ensuring that our training performance is staying still or still trying, we're trying to continue progressing. Most of the time you won't continue progressing, but we're trying as hard as we can to continue progressing in our training throughout the weeks. And this all comes down to tracking your training performance. If you're not tracking your training performance, then you're not gonna know if your lifts are going up or down, and it's gonna be impossible for you to know whether your performance is maintaining or it's going down the drain. And without tracking the right data, then you're just going blindly into things. You're kind of just shooting a gun from the hip and hoping that you hit something. And this is going to affect how much muscle you hold onto and your end physique at the end of the fat loss phase. So we always wanted to hold onto as much muscle tissue as we can, lose as much fat as we can, and then that'll result in the best recomposition, body recomposition, and the best physique at the end of the fat loss phase. So the great thing about how I do things at Team Adonisi is your training won't be affected when you're in a smaller deficit. Because of such a small deficit, you're still going to have energy. Your carbs are still going to be very, very high. So glycogen's going to be, you know, in your muscles. Yes, your training may get affected a little bit and you may lose a little bit of not so much strength, but just like sheer willpower to train. Because, you know, you're in a fat loss phase and, you know, you are thinking about food, even though the deficit is small, but, you know, the feeling of food is always there, like, you want treats and all that stuff like that. It's always going to be there during a fat loss phase, but your training won't be affected for 95% of the fat loss phase, no matter how long it goes for, because of that smaller deficit. And touching on how long it goes for, in terms of phase length, for a fat loss phase, fat loss phases can go from anywhere from 6 to 25 weeks. Now, 25 weeks, you're like, whoa, that is a long time to be in a deficit. Yeah, it would be a long time if, like, you just went in a 1,000 cal deficit. Then, you know, could you imagine that shit? Could you imagine being in a deficit of 1,000 calories for 25 weeks? You would want to rip your hair out. You would want to just binge eat all the time because you'd be starving yourself, okay? And with probably added cardio on top of that, added steps on top of that, you know, stuff that. So 25 weeks, yes, it can go that long if your rate of loss is, like I recommend, 500 to 400 calories per week. And if your rate of loss is there, then, of course, your phase length can go from, you know, anywhere from 6 to 25 weeks. And it all depends on where your BMI is at. It all depends on how much fat you need to lose, how much weight you need to drop. That all depends and all has a factor to play. Also external factors, like you could be going away, you're preparing for summer, you're preparing for a holiday to get lean. then all those factors will come into play also. And I'll discuss these more in a further podcast and also touch on why BMI, in my opinion, gets a bad rap and why it's so important for setting clear objectives for fat loss savers. Anyway, guys, that is pretty much it for this podcast. Hopefully it sounded and, you know, when you're listening to me talk and kind of felt a little bit more natural, and it didn't really feel like me reading off notes, because, yeah, I can see how that can be draining and not the easiest thing to listen to. So hopefully this felt more natural. Like I said at the start of the podcast, I appreciate all the feedback and the good feedback that I get on these. So continue to do that if you guys chimed in last time. And I'll see what guests and stuff I can bring on in the future to make sure there's some back and forth chat. But yeah, in terms of topics going forward, I'm going to cover fat loss again in a future podcast, just relating back to more things in terms of external things, like what to do in your lifestyle, how your lifestyle changes during a fat loss phase, how to kind of get around social events, things like that. I'll cover that in a future podcast. But if there's any topics that you guys want me to cover specifically, then let me know and I'll see what I can do about covering those topics and get some valuable information out there. Anyway, guys, that is it. That is all there is to the podcast. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it, and I will catch